So, good morning and welcome to worship on this, the 12th Sunday after Pentecost. We are gathered here in God's sanctuary on this beautiful day out amidst creation, and we give thanks to be gathered here together today. For those of you online who will join us later, we send our greetings to you as well. This coming week is going to be a busy CLC week, so please do take note of your announcements. I'm not quite sure how it happened, but already this coming Saturday is our spaghetti dinner fundraiser for the hiker season. And so we hope that you are all able to join us for that, either to help or simply to come and eat spaghetti. And we will be beginning our preparations at noon on Saturday. So at least portions of us will be here at noon to start getting things ready. The food will be ready to start serving at 4 o'clock. Please invite neighbors, friends, family. The more people we get, the more funds we are able to raise in support of the hikers that will be coming through next year.
Pastor?
Yeah.
Just to let everybody know, the press release did make the paper this week. It's on the back page of the Record, the Times, and the New Sun.
All right.
Great.
We are in the news, so thank you, Charlene.
Well, I've been telling the senior center, so
okay.
I got a lot hopefully going to come.
Fantastic. That
and
would
we
be
have more of our pretty posters if anybody wants to take any and you know somewhere you'd like to put them. That would be great.
Yeah, I made Lisa hand them out at work, so take them at will. As well, then, to recover, I guess, we are going to go bowling next Sunday in the afternoon, so we'll kind of bring a brown bag lunch for anybody who would like to do that, and then head over to the new Bloomfield Perry Lanes. Bill.
We're going up to Mama's Pizza.
We are going up to Mama's Pizza, so don't bring a brown bag lunch. That's in the one in New Bloomfield.
Yes, right, right across the street
okay.
from the
bowling alley. So we are going to go get pizza before we bowl.
Pizza,
so.
Subs,
okay.
Salads.
All right. That was new news to me, so that is wonderful. And even if you don't bowl, I am sure that there will be enough bowling to watch that you are welcome to come along for that. So it is a busy weekend next weekend. It is Bible Quest on Thursday for those of you who are participating in the discussion group for that. And I will put in a plug coming up soon for Bible Quest. We are going to reach the cycle where we are going to start the New Testament. We read in this cycle the New Testament twice, and we are coming to the point that we will be starting the New Testament again, so you would be able to feel like it is a fresh start, even though we are far into the year, and we are going to be alternating that with the prophets. So this would be a perfect new starting point for anybody who has said, oh, I haven't caught up or I missed it, got behind. This is another good starting point coming up in the next couple of weeks. So please be thinking about that. We would love to have as many people joining us for our Bible reading as we can. So the prophets and the New Testament will really take us all the way through the end of the year and straight into Advent as we will begin preparing for that sooner than we think. So, are there other announcements in the congregation?
Just that the sign up sheet is here if you want to bowl.
What's the cost?
It's $10 per person, and that covers 3 games of bowling and your shoes. So right now we have 2 lanes, 2 alleys, whatever you call them, reserved. So if we get any more, we might want to think about a third one.
You $15. I'll get the other $5 from somebody else.
Well, what class? Don't pay any attention to him.
Thelma.
Prayers for my son-in-law and grandson. They were leaving this morning to drive Jackson back down to the naval base in Goose Creek, South Carolina. It's a 10-hour drive.
Okay.
Wow. So,
For those of us from Michigan, that's just not that long.
Jackson hasn't driven since last November.
Goodness.
And he got a car, but he was afraid to drive that far by himself. So his dad's going with him, and his dad has to get from there to where he's going.
Okay. Very much, yes, pray for safe travel. All right. With that, we do wish Becky and Warren a happy anniversary coming up this week. And also Marion, who will be celebrating her birthday this coming Friday. So blessings to them on this year ahead. With that, we will begin our worship together. In this setting, I am perfectly fine. There is no harm done if we remain seated and are not standing up and down through this time. So we are going to keep this casual, and we will begin with our opening dialogue. Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy.
For you judge the peoples with equity and guide all the nations on earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has brought forth its increase.
God, our own God, has blessed us.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God. For in the beginning, your spirit moved over the waters, and by your word, you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in a unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
We sing our gathering hymn together.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am.
and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We will sing our hymn of praise, verses 1 and 2.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior,
Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance will be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel. I will gather others to them besides those already gathered.
That is all
you're
doing for reading.
Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We will acclaim the gospel together.
Hallelujah, Lord and Savior, open now your saving word. Let it burn like fire within us, speak until our hearts are stirred. Hallelujah, Lord, we sing for the good news that you bring.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 15th chapter.
Praise,
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said?" Jesus answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then Jesus said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see? Whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer. But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But Jesus did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." Jesus answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." Jesus answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." The woman said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Before Martin Luther was a great leader and powerful reformer, he was an angry, frustrated professor, priest, and monk. He was a believer who was struggling with his faith. Not his faith in Jesus, really, but struggling with how to live that faith out in the world and in the church he knew. What Luther was seeing all around him seemed convoluted and confusing. Penance seemed like an unending work of trying to earn salvation and forgiveness rather than the gift of compassion and grace it was supposed to be. And so Luther began his quest to get back to the heart and soul of the gospel was his goal. He searched the scriptures, he studied and he prayed. He was in search of answers. He relied upon and cried out to the Holy Spirit to help him. He wondered, how can he be sure that he's done enough, that he's confessed enough, that he's asked for forgiveness enough? And the answer Luther discovered was profound and simple at the same time. How do we ensure that we have done enough? We can't, because it is not our work to do. We do not earn our salvation. Luther found laid out in Paul's letters this amazing gift. We are saved by grace alone, an act of profound mercy and love that came to us from God through the death and resurrection of God's Son by the power of the Holy Spirit. The simple truth of this became the foundation and bedrock of Luther's teaching and the Reformation of the church. Luther assured us the scriptures are clear and simple. And then he spent the rest of his life preaching and writing and fighting with other scholars to prove just how simple it all was. Luther's own writings comprise 55 volumes of explanation of these simple scriptures. Our doctrine of faith for the Lutheran Church is compiled in the Book of Concord, which is more than 500 pages long. The simplicity of scripture has been studied for millennia, argued over by scholars and theologians and scientists and clergy and faith-filled disciples like all of us for centuries. The Protestant Reformation resulted in at least 12 different denominations, of which the Lutheran faith is just one. There are, in fact, three different bodies of the Lutheran Church in the United States, with 40 different constituted bodies of Lutheran churches in North America alone, many which hold differing faith views. Most recently, our own ELCA experienced a division in 2009 when a number of congregations left the ELCA over disagreement of same-sex marriage and the ordination of LGBTQ+ pastors. How could such a simple message be so complex and fraught with argument and disagreement? The truth is, God forgive us, Luther, the truth is that is utterly apparent by the reality of thousands of years of study is that the scriptures are not simple. They are not straightforward. They are complex and sometimes confusing and sometimes contradictory. And our lessons today reveal this. Throughout the Old Testament, we hear proclamations coming from the prophet that all nations will come to worship the God of Israel. Indeed, the God who created the entirety of this beautiful earth of which we are surrounded today, and the cosmos in which we dwell as an earth that is just a tiny speck. The God who created order out of chaos and nothingness calls all the world to God's self.
Amen.
So the scriptures say. The Old Testament tells us the story of the Hebrew people whom God chose to be a holy people, to be a sign and symbol to reflect faithful worship of the one true God for all people. In the evolving human story, there are times and places where certain rules and regulations are applied in the scripture, but they are not always demanded for all time and in all places. For example, in the book of Deuteronomy, the Bible clearly states that those who dwell in the land of Moab, the Moabites, they are terrible people. They are to be excluded from the community. Stay away from the Moabites. They are not allowed to dwell among God's people. But then, Ruth, the Moabite woman whom we hear of in our scriptures, marries into a Jewish family, and she will become the grandmother of the great King David and the ancestress of Jesus of Nazareth. The Bible is also clear in Deuteronomy 23. Foreigners and eunuchs are to be excluded from worship. But in the prophet Isaiah's words of prophetic truth, both eunuchs and foreigners will be included in God's family.
Amen.
In Isaiah 56:5, the verse right before our lesson from today begins, God proclaims that eunuchs, those who Deuteronomy told us would be excluded. Isaiah says, God proclaims that eunuchs will be given a name better than sons and daughters. And then Isaiah goes on to proclaim that foreigners, non-Jews, Gentiles, all of us, we will be people who will come to God's holy place to worship and lift up our prayers and offerings.
Amen.
The Lord God will gather the outcasts of Israel and others besides. God has made it clear that the message of salvation is for all people, not just some of the people. So when we read our gospel today, we are left scratching our head and wondering whether Jesus just might have missed the memo. Does Jesus need to head back to Hebrew school and reread Isaiah? Because today a Gentile woman comes to Jesus asking for his help to heal her daughter, and Jesus says no. Well, at first he just simply ignores her. But when she keeps asking, she refuses to leave and will not accept Jesus's no. Jesus tells her he was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And yet still the woman will not accept this. Her daughter needs the healing that she knows that Jesus can provide.
Amen.
So she humbles herself before him. She says that she accepts even the crumbs from the Son of David that will heal her daughter. And in that moment, Jesus' eyes are opened. Perhaps a Holy Spirit moment for Jesus. Jesus proclaims her to be a woman of great faith, and her daughter is healed. No matter what Luther tries to tell us, this story is not simple. There are no easy answers here. For me, I have to read the story and believe that there is more to it that we're missing. Because the compassionate, loving, self-sacrificing Jesus who washes the feet of even the one who betrayed him just would not act so cruelly to this desperate woman, would not leave her scrambling for the crumbs laying on the floor at Jesus' feet. But even if we are forced to take this story as it is in all its complexity, the gift that we can see is that the promise of God's salvation grows and expands always. It reaches out in all directions. It gathers up all of God's people. There are none who are excluded, not Gentiles, not foreigners. God leaves no one out. There is no one cast aside. So this leaves us to ask, in our world and in our own time, where so many are flung away as outcast and unwanted, undesirable and rejected, do we heed God's own voice proclaimed by the powerful prophet Isaiah, telling us that all are welcome and all belong to God? And if that is true, if all people belong to God, if we believe that God's love extends to all, if that is God's intention, then we as a people of faith are called to question and pray so deeply about those whom we have cast aside,
Amen.
Or who have been cast aside by our culture and Amen. In our nation.
Amen.
Who we have driven out is a question that should be on our mind. Who have we declared to be beyond our acceptance? Who would we send away from our fellowship tables? Who would we leave to collect the scraps from our table? Who do we reject? Who do we say does not belong here in our worship or in our country? Too often we ignore this question, leaving the suffering alone and despised. The homeless, the poor, the mentally ill, those with addictions, migrants and immigrants, those who are foreigners, as the Bible calls them, and members of the LGBTQ community, just to name a few. How can we exclude these people.
Amen.
If God doesn't, how can we hate when God's love encompasses all? These are questions of our time. These are questions for our church. How can we support division and separation when Christ opens his arms for all on the cross?
Amen.
This faith-filled, brave Canaanite woman reminds us that our own bodily witness for truth and salvation and equity and acceptance is blessed by God. She offers to us today, 2,000 years later, a bold, powerful witness. Let us learn from her courage. Let us embrace all God's people just as God does. Let us be guided and open to change and reform and repentance. May the power of the Holy Spirit lead us and bring the kingdom around us and in us and through us, just as God planned.
Amen.
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 Together, we will sing our hymn of the day.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me down, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
As one people of God, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of peace with one another.
Peace be with you.
Peace, honey.
Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation.
What is she doing? Move her chair over. She's right on the edge.
For your church in all the world, loving God,
hear our prayer.
Make your church into a house of prayer for all the peoples of the earth, that men and women in every place may love your name and joyfully offer their lives in obedient service.
Here, I'll quit.
For the earth and all of its inhabitants, loving God,
hear our prayer.
Clean, polluted skies, seas, and soil, provide nourishment to plants and animals, and make us aware of our impact on the environment. Teach us to be good stewards of our earth, for the world and for its leaders, loving God,
hear our prayer.
You call leaders to bridge differences and practice generosity. Inspire all in authority to protect people in harm's way. Deliver those in bondage. Support fair elections. Provide care for military personnel and veterans. And show mercy to those for whom they have responsibility. For the sick and those in distress, loving God,
hear our prayer.
You provide for those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Embrace people who have been rejected because of difference. Heal trauma caused by racism or prejudice. Shield any who are persecuted. Console the dying and heal the sick. Among those known to us, we pray for Shirley, Alan, Pat, Audrey, Arlene, Sarah Jane, Roger, Charlotte, Joanne, John, Jack, Kathy, Millie, Jerry, Roxy, Karen, Joe, and Ardenna. For those who now rest from their labors, loving God,
hear our prayer.
We thank you for our ancestors in the faith. Motivate us by their lives of dedication to the gospel until that day when we join with them in our eternal home. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, in the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles. As we steward ourselves and our church into deeper discipleship, let's remember Jesus' words. It's not so much about razor edge adherence to law and strictures, but rather how one lives the life of faith. An authentic and faithful witness is needed for these difficult and shifting times.
Praise God, from
whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
For those who are gathered here, there is a basket to collect offering on the table if you would like to place your offering there. For those who may be worshiping online or remotely this week, certainly please go to our online giving page through our website at clcduncannon.org. It's in your bulletin, where you will find the ability to donate and share your offerings for this week. Let us pray. Jesus,
bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. And if your neighbor's in need of help, help them along with their prepackaged communion. And we are working through the conclusion of communion. Let us sing our communion hymn. Verse 1.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Before we begin our sending this day, we as a church would like to extend our thanks to Mike and Charlene for offering to us this beautiful place to serve as our sanctuary for this day. Amen. And we are grateful.
Amen.
People of God, may God be merciful to us and bless us. May the light of God's face shine upon us. Let God's way be known upon earth, God's saving health among all nations. May God give us blessing, and may all the ends of the earth stand in awe. Go in peace. Love your neighbor.
Thanks be to God.
We sing our sending hymn.
Later on, Jesus Christ, I will stand. He's the solid rock of my life. He's the solid rock of my life. He's the solid rock of my life. There's no other place I can hide. Till the storm that rages subsides, my voice cries to God from the flood.
redeemed in all of my days. Jesus Christ will be my heart's praise. Here on Jesus Christ I will stand. He's the solid rock of my life. He's the solid rock of my life. He's the solid rock of my life. When my days of misery are done and I stand at God's holy throne, my heart will not have any fear. In Christ's righteousness I am here. Here on Jesus Christ I will stand. He's the solid rock of my life. He's the solid rock of my life. He's the solid rock of my life.
Amen.
We at Christ Lutheran Church are
God's called love children who serve.
Go in peace. The living word dwells in you.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.